They sailed from the north, blown by the winds and carried on the currents of the oceans, to an unknown world. They brought with them a vision and the hope of finding a pastoral, gentle land like their own native Britain. But what they found was an awesome landscape, harsh, cruel, and terribly lonely. An inhospitable hell on earth, concluded Captain Cook. The first man to sight these islands. He called them South Georgia in honor of his king, George of England. A Swedish biologist on that same expedition added, South Georgia is worth less than the smallest farm in England. But the native wildlife here couldn't disagree more with the views of temporary human visitors. To them, these remote South Atlantic islands have for centuries been home, where they breed their young and are nourished by the rich marine life that flourish in the unpolluted seas around them. They're home to brutal and bloody giants. Home also to the small and gracious. The bizarre and the oddly humorous. And it is also a place where you will find the deadly serious, performing the ancient rites of death. This is a world seemingly devoid of man's doings, a playground for nature's forces, a place for brute love and bodily lust. But first impressions can be deceptive. The elephant seals appear to cry out for revenge. But none of the animals existing here has a living memory of the situation that once was. Since they were discovered, human attitudes to these islands shifted from the arrogant disdain of the early explorers to the senseless brutality of later exploiters. Nobody cared about the beauty of the landscape when the living resources of the islands could be turned into materialistic wealth. Who would use the word respect when in minutes a seal or a whale could be transformed from a biological miracle to a barrel of oil for northerly nations? Who understood when seals and penguins still filled a distant shore that happiness in a frozen paradise might have its limits? In the political cant of the time, it might have been paraphrased this way. Workers from many nations unite in a struggle against life on an inhospitable island. Show that man is a superior being. Harvest what's given to you, and God bless your work. In the early part of this century, South Georgia in the Antarctic Ocean was at the end of a rainbow, a barrel filled with gold. During the Second World War, the animals were left alone when people turned to killing each other. But in the 50s, the blubber was boiling in the pots again. The 60s came, and with it, a day unlike all others. The carnage had stopped. Bleached whalebone remained as a grim reminder of the slaughter. The workers anchored their boats for the last time and went home. Some were left behind, buried in the meager soil. 50 years of unprecedented slaughter brought massive profits to European nations and likewise massive losses to the wildlife of Antarctica. Today, the whalers are gone, but their equipment still takes a toll. It's a cruel irony that some of these reindeer should have fallen victim to the paraphernalia of death brought by the whalers. These creatures were the only forms of life that the whalers introduced to South Georgia. Now, slowly but surely, the wildlife has begun to regain territory, and in numbers. Once again, animals are masters of the beach. They seem almost to know it. Not so long ago, these elephant seals would never have dared to venture anywhere near these processing sheds and equipment, for obvious reasons. Today, they bask and relax in the sun on the very spot where so much butchering took place, totally oblivious of the ghosts that haunt this strange, eerie place. And yet, as the curious have found to their cost, death still lurks in the clutter of the rusting debris, waiting to snare the unwary. Safety can be ensured only offshore. Suddenly, the stillness and quiet of the inlet are disturbed by an ominous sound. Once the oil was rolled from here to distant markets, now oil is being rolled back to the islands barrel by barrel. Is this the prelude to further exploitation? Or can it be the beginning of an attempt at reconciliation or reparation? No, history can't be rolled back, and no matter what number of barrels are landed, the oil can never replace what was once butchered. The new visitors have other intentions. For the Dominican gulls, the old toilet with the constant flush is a perfect viewpoint. Compared to the past, today's view is very different. No longer do they see the whaling station's rubbish heaps and rotting meat and blubber. They will have to survive on the natural waste in the seal colonies. Elephant seals are marine mammals, and more marine than most, 9 or 10 months a year at sea, constantly hunting for their prey in the depths of the ocean. September and winter darkness gives way to bright summer days. The first males arrive on the shore, fat and well nourished after their time at sea. The fighting to come will be fierce, and there'll be little time to establish dominance and become the beachmaster. The winner takes all. But the seals are not alone on the beach. The scientists who've arrived from Sweden and Britain are here to study the intimate family life of the elephant seals. Their first task is to construct a scale for giants. They're devising the most gigantic weight-watching program in the world. All through the summer season, they make the deserted village of Husvik their homestead. The scientists live in the old manager's house. The objects of their research wait on their doorstep. The scientists live here as isolated as the whalers once did then. No creature comforts here. On the other hand, they have a room with a view, as a tourist brochure might say. Here, everyone must pull his own weight. No shirking of duties and no demands for extra pay or perks. The routine of survival is mixed with important research. Tom Arnbom from Sweden is in charge of the Elephant Seal Field Project for the British Antarctic Survey. Tom is considering how best to use a hunting technique he learned from the people of the rainforest, which he thinks will help him in his research. A man of principle, Tom took on the job with the important proviso that no animals would suffer or die in the name of science. That's why his knowledge of these unconventional hunting techniques might be valuable to their research. He adapts a primitive blowpipe, like that used by native hunters of the rainforest, to put a bull harmlessly to sleep. These scientists are real Weight Watchers. But the targets for their research don't volunteer to step on the scale. This giant is heading for the record books. He is the heaviest animal ever weighed alive, 2,662 kilograms. During his time on the beach, he has already lost 300 kilos, and before he leaves, he will have lost another 700. The first females have now arrived on the beach, and they found secure places in the midst of the harem, protected by a real beachmaster. It's time to give birth. The contrast is enormous. The pups weigh only 40 or 45 kilos and are within seconds thrown from the warmth of the mother's womb to the freezing cold of a polar beach. With the first contact between mother and pup, the pup's guarantee of survival is secured. They learn to understand each other's language, to hear each other's calls in the midst of a noisy harem. This is the time to feed. During the next 3 weeks, the pup drinks milk with a 60% fat content, tripling its weight, while the mother, who doesn't drink or eat at all while ashore, loses 200 kilograms of her weight. The pup is the result of last year's mating. So the harem bull becomes the adopted father of a pup. Some females don't get the peace and quiet needed to give birth. If they try to join another harem, they're forcefully brought back in line. You wouldn't expect the sun to be a problem in the cold. But even if summer temperatures seldom exceed 10 degrees Celsius, the skin of the seal can be hot and life can be unpleasant for an animal with blubber insulation used to swimming in water of sub-zero temperatures. Covered in pebbles, though, they do get some comfort. Not all adult females give birth every year. Some females that didn't conceive during last season stay out at sea, leading a life which is still a mystery to the scientists. But the scientists know the females will return next year and give birth. When, where, and how they conceive is still unknown. If life for the females and pups is relatively calm, for males it's very different. The harem bulls are busy keeping intruders away. A single bull can't be everywhere. A young male is planning his attack from a flank. The females spot him, and they signal to draw the attention of the harem bull. There's some confusion, and the beachmaster, startled by the appearance of the intruder, momentarily retreats to the sea. Disturbed by the interloper's intentions, the females become agitated. Soon, the beach resounds with the fury of battle and the pent-up passion of the aggressor's frustrated rutting instincts. Like two giant heavyweight boxers, they begin, sparring with each other, probing to find the weakness in their opponent's defenses. The struggle becomes more and more urgent, and the attacks fiercer. In this lonely arena, there is no time out. With these mighty pugilists, the fight's not unequal, but it will be to the finish. Though the struggle was hard, with no quarter given, surprisingly, the outcome of this particular confrontation wasn't fatal. And as the loser departs ignominiously, the older bull reclaims his harem and what is left of his dignity until the next time. And there will be a next time, as the young bull's instinctual urges continue to drive him on. These confrontations are always bloody and brutal, sometimes ending in death. For the Cape pigeons, the carcass is simply food, resembling the old times when earlier generations of birds thrived on whale oil, blubber, and meat rubbish, an endless but stinking food supply in the bay. November. More and more species arrive at their breeding grounds on South Georgia. The sooty albatross patrols the coastline, and its song adds seasonal flavor to the area. The pair's coordinated flight is part of the mating ritual. Away from the shoreline, the South Georgia pintail adds rarity to the bird life of the island, found nowhere else in the world. At last, the waiting is over. There is now a new urgency. The females will remain fertile for only a few days. They signal acceptance by simply staying in place when the male makes an attempt. Some couples end up in the shallow water, but their predicament doesn't prevent the male from succeeding. Even if copulation takes place here and now, the fertilized egg will not be implanted in the womb for another 3 months. Only then will the fetus start to develop. The pregnancy will last for 8 months before the females return to the same beach to give birth again. It's abundant sex for some, but frustration for others. Lonely males make sure their despair is heard. For the first time since giving birth, the pup is no longer the prime concern of the female. She is eager to conceive and takes her watchful eye from the pup. This pup is trapped under a bull. An accident, yes, but the bull is totally blinded by male aggression and lust. This is the result of its frustration. The pup's life is crushed out of his small body. The giant petrels and skuas are part of the cleanup team on the beach. These are subantarctic vultures. The petrel shows his dominance by pretending to be more impressive than he really is. The bull doesn't really care. He has dozens of females to attend to. The reindeer are living memories of times past. Whalers, most of them Norwegians, literally waded all day in the flesh of sea mammals, but they longed to eat meat from their homeland. The reindeer was introduced to the islands. During the long, dark winter, when whaling operations came to a standstill, reindeer provided a perfect supply of fresh meat. Now the animals are totally wild. At this time of the year, the females migrate into a special valley to give birth. The reindeer bulls are left on the coastal slopes, where they will await the return of females and calves in a few months' time. Unlike their cousins in Scandinavia, they have no insects to repel, and they face no predators. But there are other dangers. This hapless creature has become trapped in the boggy marshes created by snowmelt in the summer. But rescue is to hand. Taking care not to become trapped themselves, the scientists heave and pull, and an episode that might have been fatal ends happily, with young reindeer soon back on its feet, returning to the herd. Back on the beach, the elephant seals prepare to return to sea. For a few days more, they will enjoy each other's company. The peace is interrupted by the scientist's presence. The seals are not only a number in the crowd. They become individuals with personalities, recognized by the scientists. Research has revealed that young and not so heavy females don't give birth to male pups. One explanation suggests that it's more costly to the female from an energy point of view to raise a male. A male fetus demands more of the mother's energy reserves. And so, a small female will abort a male fetus, as the prospect of survival for the male pup, once it's on the beach, is minimal. But perhaps the biggest puzzle concerns their life at sea. Maybe the solution lays in space. The scientists mount a transmitter on the animal, developed by a sea mammal research unit, and its signals picked up in space will tell us everything about their whereabouts in the oceans. A small computer will collect information about their dives. It looks cruel, but 70 days from now, when it molts, the transmitter will fall off. This female has become the scientists' favorite, but due to her aggressive behavior, they named her Mrs. Nasty. She made a remarkable non-stop swim of 2,500 kilometers before stopping to feed. The albatross patrols the southern oceans. Once in a while, the bird will see elephant seals surface. But the rest of the seal's life is hidden in oceanic darkness and only now illuminated by radio waves. The seals disperse all over the South Atlantic towards the Indian Ocean and into the Pacific Ocean. 90% of the time, Mrs. Nasty spent underwater. Her dives were generally 18 minutes long, and she surfaced to breathe only for 2 minutes between dives. This pattern was repeated week after week, 24 hours a day. Her dives reached world record depths of nearly 2,000 meters. Finally, Mrs. Nasty reached this area on the Antarctic Peninsula. Some of the species she now encounters on the beaches, she recognizes from back home in South Georgia. Others are new to her. Even if one or the other young males squabbles away in a playful fight, this is the time for peaceful molting. The elephant seals are by far the biggest marine mammals on the shore, but not the most conspicuous. The fur seals have a history as troublesome as theirs. They used to inhabit most shores in this part of the Antarctic, but their fur was valuable, and the slaughter, as a consequence, brutal. One single fur ship could kill 60,000 seals before returning to cash in at markets on distant continents. It's a time to reevaluate this period of history, time to recreate respect for the elephant seals. Elephant seals are not land animals, which sometimes happen to dive down into the sea. They're underwater animals, which come to the surface now and again. How does a seal find its favorite dish? Octopus and squid in a pitch black sea. As far as we know, the seals have no sonars like dolphins or whales. Is finding food merely a random process down in the ocean? A multitude of secrets, still mysteries, in the elephant seal's secret world. Back on South Georgia, we also find the fur seals. At the end of the 19th century, 1 million seals had been killed here, and when a final sealing expedition came in 1913, they could find only a few. But in less than 100 years, the seals have made the most remarkable recovery. Today, there are almost 1.5 million fur seals at South Georgia, and their numbers are still on the increase. There's no doubt that the fur seals are charming creatures. These king penguins have really nothing to fear. The fur seals don't eat penguins. The chase was just part of the game. It's doubtful if the penguins saw it that way. December. Fur seals lead a life to a rhythm different from the elephant seals. Now, their pups are born. The elephant seal mother didn't leave its pup's side for 3 weeks. The fur seals, on the other hand, must swim to sea in search of food to fill their reserves in order to give the pups enough milk. For this reason, fur seal pups must quickly become independent. A white fur seal isn't unusual. Scientists know that white seals are born so regularly that when wanting to count a seal population, they only need to count the white ones to get a rough estimate of the total. Or less common white penguins are, isn't known, however. Even if the hunt is over, humans continue to make life very hard for fur seals. Large numbers are trapped in gill nets, some drifting as ghost traps in the oceans. Rubbish like plastic material and abandoned rope become strangling weapons, choking seals to death after a long period of suffering. Caught in the ring as a pup, the body will grow, the rope will not. Some 5,000 seals have met their fate this way in South Georgia. The weather changes fast in the polar regions. South Georgia is no exception. In the middle of the subantarctic summer, the blizzard hits. Born on fierce winds from the Antarctic continent, snows sweep across the bays to the shore and batter their way inland. This is not man's natural environment. Yet this sudden icy storm hardly seems to affect the elephant seals still lounging casually on the beach. They're apparently quite unperturbed, protected by their fur and huge stores of blubber. Perhaps the wind and snow are a welcome relief from the warmth of the summer sun. These pups, like youngsters everywhere, are excited by their first sight of snow, and despite the sudden freezing conditions, they make the blizzard an excuse for a game. But the sun and relatively warm days will soon return, giving several species a chance to complete their breeding cycles. The shag is an efficient hunter, capable of dives more than 100 meters. They make sure their nests are built on rocky and inaccessible shores, protecting them from the game's fur seals play. The white sheathbill is a freeloader on the beach. They make sure their own nest is well protected far away from predators. Sheathbills eat everything. On their menu are mucus, blood, and feces. They are indeed strange and not easy to take a liking to. Today, the sheathbills and the other scavengers are busy elsewhere on the island. In 24 hours, the birds can remove 500 kilos of dead seal meat and blubber. This is sub-Antarctic recycling at its best. Only the bones and the skin are left to decay on the beach. The giant petrels also lead a busy life these days. The petrel must provide for itself and for its chick. The nest, hidden in the tussock grass, is private territory, rudely indicated to intruders by throwing up at them. It's not easy to believe that the beauty of this face once looked like this. The sooty albatross has chicks that look like masked bandits. 45 days of brooding shared by both parents come to an end as the king penguin chick hatches. They have no nests, and the egg is kept on top of their feet throughout incubation. Unlike other penguin species, the king penguin can't breed every year. A breeding cycle takes a complete year, after which the parents must shed feathers before starting a new cycle. Breeding about 18 months apart, they're only able to breed twice in 3 years. In South Georgia, the Antarctic penguins meet the Arctic reindeer. The reindeer, brought to the island by Norwegian whalers, were used to giving birth to their calves in May and June, the early summer in the northern hemisphere. The same behavior repeated in South Georgia would be lethal. As in May and June, it's winter in these parts. Following several years of unsuccessful reproduction, the reindeer of South Georgia changed their behavior and started to give birth in November and December, the spring of the southern hemisphere. Since then, the reindeer have adapted successfully to the South Georgian landscape. The grazing is intense, maybe too intense, because the plant cover of lichens and mosses have been grazed down to the barren soil in many places. Many other plant species have also been grazed heavily, and as they're not adapted to compete with a large herbivore, the plant communities are suffering. For the reindeer, plants by accident imported from Europe have become their saviors. Seeds that came in ships, ballast and cargo. Among the plants are sheep sorrel, birds for trefoil, dandelions, and wild chervil. At the same time as reindeer give birth to their calves, Gentoo penguins hatch. With a noise like this, it's not surprising that the Gentoo penguin is referred to as the donkey penguin. A chinstrap penguin overlooks the rookery. The survival of the chicks depend on the amount of krill caught by the parents. If this small crustacean animal isn't found in enough quantities, the chicks will die. The mother won't let go of her dead chick, but sooner or later, the bond will break and other animals will benefit from the death. The penguin rookeries of South Georgia have seen dramatic changes. Chicks have been dying in very large numbers. In this rookery, 10,000 used to live in a dense colony. Now, only a few hundred birds remain. One by one, the chicks died. And finally, the adults also left the colony to care for their own survival. It's believed that the most important production area in the ocean, the rich waters along the so-called Antarctic Convergence, moved away from the islands, making the food supply inaccessible to the penguins. The Antarctic Convergence is dynamically moving north and south in the ocean. Its position is defined by climate, water temperatures, and ocean currents. Maybe this is a first sign of what can happen if large-scale changes in global climate hit the world with unpredictable consequences. The lack of food has also drastically affected the fur seals. Early in the season, the fur seal colony prospered. Pups were born of the dense tussock. But soon the pups were left to die on the shore. Unlike Gentoo penguins and fur seals, elephant seals and king penguins are not affected by the changes in the ocean. They feed on fish and squid, which remain plentiful around the island. One parent always stays behind to protect the chick while the other one is feeding. It can happen, however, that one of the parents dies, thus forcing the other one to abandon the chick while feeding. This creates a tough situation for the chick, who is not easily accepted by other chicks or adults. There are other dangers as well. This penguin has probably been attacked by a leopard seal. The chicks put on weight with remarkable speed, building a thick layer of fat. As winter approaches, the parent birds will visit their chicks now and then to feed them. But only those young birds with a thick enough layer of blubber and enough fluffy insulation down will survive the ghastly darkness and the cold. Here they will stand every day for 9 months. The pups of the elephant seal are now on their own after 3 weeks of weaning. During the following 6 to 7 weeks, the seals will be nourished only by the layer of blubber put on during the nursing period. Their days will be spent mostly sleeping. Lacking access to females, young and frustrated males attack the pups. This is rape, even if it's mostly unsuccessful. For the pups, the exploding and unfulfilled sexual desires often leads to a frightful hiccup and a bite in the neck, but no doubt some unlucky pups get killed. The seal's natural attraction to water can lead it into dangerous places. This pup would normally have no chance to escape from this boggy ditch. He would slowly starve to death. The research team rescued this one. Some of his brothers and sisters weren't so lucky. During this period, the pups spend more and more time in the water, to play and to swim. The seal has no problems at all sleeping while in the water. Once in a while, they surface for a breath of air. The male pups have grown fast, and already they start to test their strength in combat without bloodshed. The period immediately following weaning is very important in the pup's life. It must now learn to swim and dive, creating its personal lifeline. At South Georgia, 40% of the pups die during the first year, probably because they lack the skill to find prey. 1 month later, they will swim for 12 hours, mostly at night, always playing. The seals are temporary guests on South Georgia. So are the biologists, and together they enjoy some memorable moments on the beach. This isn't dangerous if you accept that the rules of the game are dictated by the animals. But you're bound to get a different point of view when facing a seal at its level and in its environment. But there are limits to this apparent friendliness. February. After 70 days at sea, the females return to South Georgia, this time to molt. During molting, they prefer to crowd together in the peat puddles. Scientists believe that this behavior actually helps them to keep warm until a new layer of skin and fur has grown. Unlike other seals, elephant seals molt both the fur and the skin. When they last visited the island, males spent weeks fighting each other. Now they relax side by side, snoring together during the molting period. The reindeer also change their skin. The velvet on the new antlers is rich in small blood vessels that burst during the casting of the skin. This is a time of transition on South Georgia. Most animals and birds have already broken up from the breeding grounds. The pups left in January. The females will soon follow. They will leave the peace and tranquility of South Georgia to face the rigors of the open sea, where life will be very different, full of danger and uncertainty. Many will not return. But for a while longer, they continue their holiday and to enjoy the pleasure of each other's company. The brief summer is hastening to an end. When winter sets in, the reindeer will remain inland, finding food and shelter where and as best they can. As Captain Cook and his crew discovered, with its harsh and inhospitable climate, for humans at least, South Georgia is no pastoral paradise. Yet to much of the wildlife that abounds here, it is home. Now that the killing has ended, hopefully South Georgia will continue to be a safe and unpolluted haven. Uh-huh.
Oh, my God.